dad.
Aww.
Nice to meet you.
Hi, everybody. Hi, family.
Super cool. Hi, everybody. Friends. Woo, there's a good crew, you guys. Thanks for coming. Yeah. I'm going to give it just another beat and then I'll get started.
Yeah, we passed 100 people in a heartbeat. That's cool.
Yes.
Yahtzee.
That's awesome. Housing more people than we did live.
Yo, I love the chat. So much love. This is awesome.
This is great. So much.
It's going to be so much more after they see it, too.
Cannot wait.
Welcome to the ISA Table Read event. I am Molly Kash. I'm the Director of Operations for the ISA. We are so excited tonight to be here to celebrate Marshall Gripp Gillson and their pilot script, offbeat, but on point. This has been a fantastic week of rehearsals and taping and editing to bring this event to you. So thank you all for being here to be a part of it, to enjoy it. Marshall is the grand prize winner of the Table Read My Screenplay competition, and we are thrilled to be able to share this script with you. So as you may know, originally this event was planned to be at the Austin Film Festival. However, the world had some other ideas for us. So we pivoted and we brought the experience fully online. And personally, I am grateful. And I think that we got some really great new opportunities because of it. We were able to get this amazingly talented cast, actors from all over. Austin has great actors too. Don't get me wrong. I love you, Austin actors. But we have assembled a great cast from all over. And thank you, actors. You're all brilliant. You brought so much life to this and you embody the characters and your passion and your talent is just, it's wonderful. So thank you so much. Also, we were able to get the fantastic Randall Wilson as our director and Dan Samiljan as our producer. And I don't know if that would have happened had we been at a festival. And we are so thankful that we got this opportunity to spend this time with you because you two are just fantastic. It was so amazing to watch you work together and work with the cast, and really great for Marshall to have that experience to see you work together. That's part of why we actually run this table read event, this competition rather, so that the writer has the opportunity to see a director work with actors, see how that all flows, see that it be rehearsed and reworked and all of the love and what goes into it to bring it to life. And because it's taped, we had the extra opportunity of being able to work it and rework it and go back and start over and do it again and still not have a whole pilot run through all one. It doesn't matter because we can edit it and then bring it to life. And it might be a little different than it was in rehearsal. And that is part of the process. It's more like what it would be to be on a TV set. So it was just a great and valuable experience that we were all able to have and that Marshall could have. And so thank you all for being a part of it. That's the other upside to this is you don't have to be at a festival in a certain city in a room that could only fit 100. And we are well past that number. You can be in your pajamas anywhere in the world and be joining us. And so thank you for doing that. And of course, a thank you to the ISA team. This event does not start this week. It starts many, many months ago with the launch of a contest. And there are a lot of people that go into that whole process from launching a contest to reading the scripts and whittling them down to the best ones and picking the best one to showcase it. And so I wanna thank Jaren and Jordan and Jeffrey and Beth and all our readers for going through thousands of scripts. And Felicity for picking the very best one to showcase here tonight for everybody. For Diane for going through all those customer emails from both a contest side and the events. For Amy for assembling this cast, for bringing us together with Randall and Dan, for doing all the a lot of legwork on this whole week. Shayna, same, lot of legwork on this week, setting us up with Aaron and Nicole, our ASL interpreters for the night, putting the events page together. There's just a whole bunch of stuff that goes into making this this night happen. And of course, Danielle and Carissa for marketing and promoting this event, putting our program together, Danielle. And Scott, Scott, who gave us all instructions on how to light and how to set our stage, how to make everybody come to life, and was on set every day and edited all week, edit until we have our finished product, and he did a fantastic job. And of course, Craig, our leader, who keeps this ship running and who is going to be giving us the video tonight. He'll be sharing the video for us tonight. And thank you to our sponsors, The Wrap, Script Studio, and Austin Film Festival. And without further ado, I would love to hear a few words from the winning writer, Marshall Gripp Gillson, the grand prize winner of the Table Read My Screenplay competition, and our star of the evening.
This is great. I like being on video because it means that I don't have to be embarrassed in front of people. I don't know. I'm really excited. Obviously, thank you to everybody at ISA, to Randall. There's a lot of work that goes into staging an event of any kind, and it was, you know, really an honor to watch people commit that work to my writing. I don't know. Today is the Trans Day of Remembrance, and I just wanted to make sure that we took a moment of silence for that. 34 trans people have been murdered this year. It's like the official count. I suspect it's higher than that. So if everybody could just join me in that for a moment. But... thank you. So I don't know. There's a Q&A afterward. I'm sure we'll talk. Please feel free to send questions. Follow me on all your social media. Thank you again to everybody. I hope you enjoy it.
Thanks, Marshall. That was awesome. Yay. Okay, and I'd love to also hear from our director, Randall Winston. Would you care to say a few words?
Hey, thank you. I will be brief because I know we are here to watch the work, but obviously thank you so much to the ISA. Thank you, Molly and Scott and Craig for the work that you put into it. Amy, thank you for making the call. It's been a great process, and congratulations to Marshall. It's a fantastic script, a lot of fun. We have a fantastic cast, which is really great fun to work with. And you know, I think that's the magic, right? This is a collaborative process and a collaborative art, and it starts with that great script and everybody getting to try and elevate and execute. So I'll let it speak for itself, but this has been a really, really fun and exciting experience to work with this level of talent and to be part of.
Thanks, Randall. Okay, so I'm gonna ask all the actors to come on screen. But of those who could not be here tonight, I will read them and then everybody else can introduce themselves. We have Tiana Okoye playing Nima. Jackson playing Brigham. Baiinga Bangura playing Karo. And I'll let you all introduce yourselves.
Hi, I'm Anthony M. Bertram, and I'm playing Clinton.
Hi, Karen Eilbacher, you can call me Care, playing Anika.
Hi, I'm Kim Estes, playing Oscar.
Hi, my name is Eddie Williams, and I'm playing Fernando.
Hi, I'm Claudia Restrepo, and I'm playing Eligia.
Hi, I'm Ivana Lis, and I'm playing Sam. Hello, my name is Borge Etienne, and I'm playing Edgar.
Hello, my name is Kelsey Scott, and I'm the narrator.
Did we get everybody? WhySham? Did we get you?
Hello, I'm DJ WhySham, and I'm DJ WhySham.
We're all going to go off video and we're going to watch this fantastic table read, and we will see you afterwards. Thank you so much.
Interior, Living Country Gallery, night. A dimly lit art gallery, weirdo surrealist indie artwork hangs on pastel walls. An audience of 100 QPOC fill rows of folding chairs on the gallery floor. There's no stage, just a bit of space along one wall for a single microphone stand and a portable speaker. The audience applauds. A shaking teen, Karo, steps up to the mic.
I wrote this poem last week after my grandmother almost died. It was really scary. She had to spend 3 days on the Tessin.
A man struggles down an aisle back to his seat. It's too tight to get through, and everyone he passes grumbles. This is Clinton.
Excuse me? Yo, make room. Look, nobody cares if you scuff your Air Force L's. Move in.
He takes his seat next to Anika. She slouches in her chair, worn from hours of amateur performances.
Hope that blunt fed your soul, because you missed the whole open mic.
Should I name this cough Green Reaper, or did you eat your talkies too fast again?
Look, who cares? When am I getting an award?
What award?
You said I had to come so they could give me some songwriting award.
Your last song was in 2009. What award they giving you? You got a new collab with Susan Boyle?
That is fucked up.
The crowd applauds mildly as Karo steps off stage. Nima steps up to the mic. Dark-skinned, soft-spoken, and irresistibly cute, she entices the room with a casual kindness.
All right, keep it going for Karo, everyone. Ah, he's being shy. He's actually an incredible artist. You see that?
She motions off stage to a large asymmetrical chair tucked into one of the gallery's nooks. It might be big enough to fit two people, but for its unusual shape, and its smooth wooden seat is covered with an intricate painting of a wizard casting a torrent of knives toward an enormous crystal ball.
He actually painted that. By hand.
The audience gasps, nods, snaps their fingers.
What the hell am I doing here?
Shh, this is her.
All right, that's the end of our open mic list, but I thought I would close this out with one of my songs. That I?
The crowd whoops. Clinton's scowl softens into confusion as he notices people on both sides of him pulling out phones to record.
Y'all too much. All right, this song is... Nah, I think it speaks for itself.
Exterior, Living Country Gallery, later that night. Anika and Clinton have stepped outside the gallery to debate. Some of the crowd is spilling out, too.
Why does every new rapper sound like they can't hear the track? She was all off beat.
But on point, though.
Seriously? Nobody even seemed into it.
She got a 6-minute standing ovation.
It felt like a lecture. Made me want to drop out of school again.
You said you wanted someone who could lend social political context to your narrative.
Nah, I said I wanted to pose with an AR on the cover. You the one talking all that conscious shit.
Right, gotta maintain your gangster brand if you're gonna land that cameo on Queen Sugar.
They need my age.
Just meet with her.
Fine, whatever. Set it up.
Thank you. You want to wait in the car?
Nah.
You sure?
Clinton waves his blunt at her. She shrugs and walks off. Clinton sighs and leans against the picturesque front window of the gallery to light his blunt. Behind him in the window, Anika approaches Nima. They chat for a moment. Clinton takes a long pull on his blunt. Anika reaches into her jacket to produce a business card and hands the card to Nima. Clinton releases a cloud of smoke into the air. Nima looks down in awe, the business card in her hand. Anika Rayner, artist and repertoire, Swayami Records. Oscar calls out to Nima over the chatter of the crowd leaving.
Who was that?
Nima looks up to see her smiling father leaning heavily on his cane. She smiles back.
Call you later.
Interior, Oscar's brownstone, the next day. Superstar by Lauren Hill plays as Nima readies for her day. The shower head sputters on. She throws her head back as the water rolls down her face. She dances around the kitchen with a skillet, slides a fried egg onto her avocado toast. Nima bounces up the street in time with the song still playing in her puffy over-the-ear headphones. Interior. Living Country Gallery bathroom. Continuous. Nima sits on the toilet seat lid, lit joint in one hand, pen in the other, notebook propped in front of her, smoke cutting the light of the cramped bathroom. Fully flied up again, she nods to the beat, headphones on. She takes a pull of the joint, mumbles, thinking. She drops the pen down to the notebook about to write, but doesn't. She lifts it back up. She pulls her headphones off one ear, trying to identify the sound. Interior, Living Country Gallery. The chairs and the mic are gone. Oscar struggles to drag the wizard chair across the suddenly very sparse gallery floor. Nima enters with her notebook and pen, headphones hanging around her neck.
Papa, what are you doing?
Practicing my b-boy routine. What'd it look like?
Skrr! Oscar plops down on the chair as Nima approaches.
You smoking back there?
No.
Mm-hmm.
Let me get on it. You're about to put your whole back on corkscrew.
Oscar stands up so Nima can lift the chair. The two meander toward the front of the store.
Someone at the show wanted to buy it.
No shit!
Nima!
Sorry, but Karo will be so excited. He's been trying to move it since before Game of Thrones ended.
Well, guy said he'd come by this afternoon.
Oh.
You'll be around?
I'm supposed to meet...
Oh, got it.
Yeah, that woman from the label.
Well, just try to remember me when you're jet skiing with Patty LaBelle.
Patty drive a jet ski?
Well, whomever then.
Nima puts the chair down by the door, next to the lectern serving as a makeshift box office.
I'll come back right after. It's easier to write here anyway.
Thank you.
He steps forward to brush some ash from Nima's sweater.
You might want to get some eye drops too.
Exterior, office building, later that day. Nima squeezes drops into her eyes as the bus pulls away. She dashes for the door, pulls the headphones down from her ears. Interior, lobby. Moments later, Nima plops down onto a bench and digs in her bag to produce her notebook and pen. She stares down at a blank page, exasperated. She lifts her pen to press point to paper, but Anika interrupts.
What are you working on?
Interior, hallway. Moments later, the elevator doors open and Anika leads Nima out.
We only rent half, but the other side is vacant, so we got the whole place to ourselves.
Yeah. I don't even know Swami had an office around here. I thought they were headquartered in LA.
Delaware, but I actually work with a subsidiary label.
What subsidiary?
Anika swings open the office door. Interior, Bullet Mob office, continuous. Nima follows Anika in. The office is open and spacious with a couple of small rooms jutting from the large main lobby. Clinton sits on the reception desk, crouched over a framed platinum record laying on the surface in front of him. The smile on his face might read as nostalgia, except he's rolling a blunt on the glass.
Nima Bird, meet
Clinton Phillips.
Clint Hood, actually.
Founder and CEO of Bullet Mob Records. He goes by his stage name.
I don't go by my government.
Have a seat. First of all, glad you can make it. We both loved your performance last night. You challenged the audience to really think.
More like forced us at gunpoint.
Anika shoots Clinton a dirty look.
Which you know is my style.
Clint has been working on some new tracks. We wanted to talk about ways you could contribute.
But you want me to ghostwrite?
We want you to collaborate. We think there's overlap between your artistic identities.
Really?
Oh, no doubt. You're both from around here. There's continuity to your experiences. Your stories inform each other.
And trust, I don't need no ghostwriter. You worry about your own shit.
I wrote all the time. Thanks.
Yeah? Who you been listening to?
Lauren Hill.
Ain't that a little before your time?
Yeah, it was my mom's favorite, actually. She's got this real casual flow I'm trying to learn.
Great. You into a lot of old school?
You picked up some bad habits. We gotta teach you how to rap on beat.
We're really excited about the new techniques you got going on to, you know.
Strict tempo is a European invention. They made up words for syncopation and polyrhythm when they heard Black music.
All that textbook shit make you feel bad about biting off a 20-year-old flow?
I feel you. You're more about brand new trash.
Oh, it's like that?
Oh, you ain't like facts, so I figured we were playing the dozens.
Oh, you want some? Shit's supposed to be good for your period cramps.
Nima nods complete understanding, stands, and walks out the door. Anika turns enraged to Clinton.
Are you fucking serious?
Clinton shrugs. Anika runs out to chase after Nima. Clinton takes another pull and wipes the ash on the framed record. Exterior, office building, moments later. Anika rushes out of the building, searching for Nima. Standing at the bus stop, Nima notices Anika over her shoulder and pretends she doesn't.
Nima, don't leave, please.
Save it for Quentin Miller.
Please, just come back inside. I know Clint kind of asshole.
Like shit kinda smells?
I can introduce you at Swayomi. We can get you signed, fam.
Yeah? Get me studio time, shows, merch?
Everything.
Exactly how Meg the Stallion ended up suing the label.
Hey. Gotta make something worth suing over first.
Not all that shit. I can have it without you. I already do.
At least let me call you a car.
I'm good.
Nima boards the bus. Anika turns back to the building, alone on the curb as the bus pulls off. Interior, bus, day. Nima drops into a bus seat toward the back. She pulls her headphones on and digs through her bag for her notebook. She flips open the cover but doesn't even have time to turn the page before her phone buzzes. Frustrated, she snaps the notebook closed and struggles her phone out to look at it. Incoming call. Papa. She picks up and greets Oscar.
Hey, Papa, I'm on my way back.
Well, don't come home just yet. I need you to go see that guy about the chair.
Well, what happened? He ain't come through?
Well, he came, but he didn't have cash. Nima.
Sorry.
But that should put us in the black for this month at least. Last thing, I promise.
Nima gathers her notebook back into her bag.
I got you. Text me the address.
Okay. Love you, Nima.
Love you.
She hangs up, pulls the bus's stop cord. The bell dings and stands to huff back toward the door. Interior. Bullet Mob office, moments later. Back perched on the desk, Clinton taps angrily at his smartphone. The door swings open and Anika enters. He doesn't look up.
Yo, what's good? Did we sign her?
Nigga, is you serious? No, we ain't signing her. What the fuck is wrong with you?
The plug tripping? All that money I spent on is endo-hydro-crypto bullshit and he talking about he don't deliver.
Will you take this seriously? I'm trying to get you paid.
I'm already paid. Niggas need to respect me like they respect Obama.
Obama ain't on no more either.
What you trying to say?
Nima's not wrong. Yo, you've been searching for a new sound, and she can help you find it.
You are fucking fired.
What? I don't work for you. I work for Swayomi.
Oh, you don't think I could get you fired?
Can you? Anybody recognize you at the show last night? Huh? Can't get your weed guy to deliver?
Yo, pack your shit and get out!
He snatches his phone and storms out into the hallway. Anika sighs. She reaches into her jacket pocket to produce a cell phone, taps at the screen. To D at Swayami. We got anything left in the scouting budget? Interior, parlor, later that day. A gaunt white king wearing a gaudy jewel-studded gold crown, inner painted in a bulky crystal ball, sitting on the end table. Nima examines the artifact curiously. She's seated by the arm of an extravagant, tufted leather sectional in a strangely rustic parlor. The crystal ball is one of the room's many unusual artworks. Brigham comes back into the room, stuffing dollar bills into an envelope.
Sorry about that. Didn't realize you guys were cash only.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, waiting for money from credit card companies is like watching grass grow. A few years back, we had to.
Yeah, they got these new things called checks. Should look into it.
Yeah. Yeah, thanks.
She pulls the money out and flips through the bills, counting under her breath.
You don't trust me?
Oh, you could just never be too careful. When are you planning to come pick up the piece?
Nima finishes her count, shakes her head, and starts over.
I can't get back here till next Monday. Just hold on to it till then.
This is 75 short.
You sure?
Yeah, it's 300 for the chair plus a 25% service fee.
What's the service fee for?
Finding the piece, showcasing it, and coordinating the sale. Just trying to keep the grass growing, you know?
Maybe you could give me a discount then. Knock a couple bucks off the chair. Look, that's all I got.
Nima glances down again at the garish crystal ball. The king is smug. She drops the envelope onto the side table and stands to leave.
We'll be in touch.
Interior, Clinton's condo later that day. Clinton stands tall, smirking at himself in a full-length mirror, decked out in all black everything, a lot of leather. On the dresser sits a clunky statue of Clinton with arms wide, posing like Jesus. The statue version of Clinton wears a chain with a Jesus pendant in the same pose. Full-size Clinton slides the statue out of the way to reveal a jewelry box. He snaps the box open to reveal a resplendent, glimmering, gem-studded watch. His eyes widen. The watch glints as he straps it to his right wrist. Self-satisfaction on his face as he slides on a pair of sunglasses. Interior, black SUV, moments later. Clinton climbs into the big black SUV and fastens his seatbelt. Up front, the driver accepts the ride on his mounted smartphone. This is Fernando.
Hello, and thank you for choosing to ride with us. How has your day been so far?
I'm all right, bro.
Yo, you look kind of familiar. Yo, ain't you that nigga from The Matrix?
Nah, I'm...
Oh, shit, you a rapper, right? You, Clint Hook.
Right.
Yo, damn, you like a legend, bro.
Yeah, I really mentor.
I mean, not like a legend, but damn, bro, that one joint on your last mixtape, I'll be in the heezy for sheezy. I would take the VD over the Edie, believe me.
Clinton holds the grab handle tight as Fernando starts tapping at his phone, trying to pull up the song. Fernando's eyes aren't on the road.
That shit had me rolling, bro.
Yo, watch out!
The SUV swerves to narrowly avoid getting smashed on the passenger side by a garbage truck.
My nigga's never gonna believe this. I never be getting celebrities up in here. So, where you going, fam?
Amplify.
Where, yeah. That place is always popping. So you got the freshies on too. Drippin' wet. Damn, how much they paying you to be there?
You know I don't be talking about numbers, dog.
Right. I feel you. I'm gonna be real though. I didn't even know the place opened this early.
Interior, diner, moments later. Clinton and Fernando sit across from each other in a booth, chewing matching sandwiches.
Yo, you using that ketchup?
Nah, I saw you, dog.
Clinton reaches to grab the bottle, squirts it on his plate. Interior, Karo's house, later that day. A small living room. The treasures here are quaint, knickknacks acquired from a lifetime of bartering and making do. Nima and Karo sit on opposite sides of a coffee table of dubious stability. Karo's back is to a tall mirror.
I thought you'd be excited it was finally selling.
No, I am. I've been trying to sell that chair since Spider-Verse came out.
And you said you could use the cash.
Nana is getting sick again.
Look, I know it's not as much as you thought, but this is what you want, right? To get money for your art?
It cost me $250 to buy the chair. I saved up for 4 months. If I sell it for $225, I'm not really making anything, am I?
Karo.
You always talking about putting the art first and valuing ourselves as creators. How can I do that if I'm letting people talk me into less than I'm worth? Isn't that how I turn into a sellout?
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to pressure you.
I know. But You're right. We need the cash, so I guess tell him I'll take it.
Karo gets up and slinks out of the room, Nima dejected. Across the table, only her reflection is left. Exterior, Amplify nightclub that night. Clinton waves at Fernando as he climbs out of the SUV.
Thanks, bro.
5 stars.
Clinton slams the door. He turns around to face the bustling club, chest puffed out, bursting with the night's potential. Interior, Amplify nightclub later that night. Clinton, slumped on an extremely tacky sofa with a half-empty glass of brown liquor. The strobe lights disappear random chunks of his highly indifferent expression. He wanders over to the booth where DJ WhySham is spinning hard, rocking to the very loud music.
Yo, 50 cash if you shout me out.
Huh?
50 cash if you shout me out on the mic.
Who you?
Clint Hook.
Hook in the building. Pay me.
Clinton glares, but puts a $50 bill in her hand. From across the room, some guy named Edgar notices Clinton and approaches.
Hey, Clint Hook, what's good, baby?
He holds his hand out to Dap, and Clinton grasps it.
Hey, nice to meet you, bruh. What the fuck?
Edgar was grabbing at Clinton's wrist. Clinton shoves him away.
You trying to steal my watch?
Hey, daddy-o, you got it on the wrong wrist, dumbass.
Edgar scurries off as Clinton switches his watch to his left wrist.
Piece of shit.
Hey, you tell him, Papi.
Clinton turns to see two young women, Eligia and Sam, batting their eyelashes at him.
This doesn't really seem like your kind of party, but we were about to get out of here. Do you want to give us a ride?
I definitely need another drink first.
Interior, Clinton's condo later that night. Huge purple buds of marijuana in a mason jar. Clinton is wrapped.
Cost me an extra bill and make him deliver, but this shit is always worth it.
He turns back around to Eligia and Sam, who sit on the edge of the bed in their underwear. Clinton is completely naked, and it has done nothing to change his demeanor.
You two smoking or what?
No, we're fine.
Well, shit. More for me, then.
That's not really why we're here. Entiende?
I don't know why that Spanish shit gets me going every time. Damn.
He squeezes her face.
Just give me a second to roll this first.
Clinton turns to the nightstand, pulls open the drawer, and starts digging around inside.
I think I even got some backwards in here somewhere.
And he collapses. Behind him, Sam wields the statue of Clinton posed as Jesus.
Damn, this thing is heavy.
It thuds to the floor next to Clinton as she drops it.
Told you he'll fall for that whole hey papi shit. I mean, you were right. Credit where it's due. Oh, grab the bud.
Wait, where did you put the watch?
Interior, Living Country Gallery, moments later. Keys jingle as Nima unlocks the door and enters. Oscar is asleep, sitting upright in a folding chair, head leaned all the way back, snoring gently. Nima approaches and rests a hand on his shoulder.
Papa, let's go home.
Oh, Nima, the chair, shit.
Papa.
I'm sorry.
I didn't get the money.
No, I meant to call.
Well, the guy wanted to short us. I talked to Karo, but.
No, don't worry about it. I sold the chair.
To who?
Some lady came in asking about it. She offered $1,500 and had the cash with her. So I figured you got to get the cat in the bag before you skin it.
I don't think that's a saying.
Oh, yeah. Oh, money's on the podium. Let me get my coat.
Oscar stands and ambles off toward the back. Nima walks back to the lectern by the door. She lifts the envelope sitting on top of it and peers inside. Fans through the stack of crisp $100 bills, relief on her face. Beneath the bills is a business card. Nima's eyes are curious as she pulls it out and flips it over. Anika Rayner, Artist and Repertoire, Swayami Records. Interior, Anika's apartment, moments later. Anika, curled up on the couch, shoes off, sipping a glass of wine. Her phone rings. She looks down at its screen. It's Nima. She lifts the phone to her ear.
Anika Rayner speaking.
You can't buy me.
Sorry, who's calling?
You think I'm gonna sign over some tracks to you just because you paid some bills?
Nope.
You think I'm just paper chasing?
I don't.
Then why'd you come back around the gallery?
You finished writing that song?
I was out dealing with some clients today.
So part of it is paper chasing then. This might surprise you, Nima, but I like your music and I want people to hear it. Clint is terrible and the industry is unfair, whatever. I know money isn't everything, but it is something. Isn't that what you want? To get money for your art?
Nima looks at herself carefully in the mirror over the sink.
It's not the only thing. So if we're gonna do this, we're gonna have to do it right.
Right, like what?
Well, I own the masters, Bullet Mob can distribute, but all of my songs are still mine. I want full creative control.
I can probably swing that with your songs, but Clint's contract says all his tracks belong to Swayomi.
I thought he owned his label.
Bullet Mob is really just branding. It's not even incorporated by itself. They basically named a hamburger after him and told him he owns McDonald's. So we have a deal?
Yeah. Yeah.
Why don't you come back to the office tomorrow and show me what you're working on?
Okay. Yeah. Tomorrow.
Good night, Nima.
Interior, bathroom, later that night. A haze of smoke clouds the room. Nima's head nods to the beat in her headphones. Her whole body sways. Leaned back in the empty tub, headphones on, she takes another pull on a joint before returning to the notebook open in her lap. She scribbles a few words, stops to mumble them back, writes a little more. She performs silently to herself for a moment, then puts the pen down, closes her notebook, and leans her head back, satisfied. Interior. Bullet Mob office, continuous. Clinton barges through the door and heads straight for the desk. He is already rummaging through a drawer when Anika greets him.
Hello.
He looks up. Anika sits opposite Nima, who reclines on Karo's painted chair. Clinton buries his head back in the drawer.
What are you doing here?
He slams the drawer closed and examines the marker he pulled from it. He shakes it next to his ear to check it, then pops the bottom off. It's been hollowed out. He produces a blunt from inside.
She called me back to...
He means me. He thinks he fired me.
So we did sign her then.
Yeah, Anika and I worked it out. Why, we got a problem?
Anika's phone chimes and she pulls it out to address it.
So what's with the sunglasses?
Hangover, headache, maybe a concussion.
He leans so she can see the enormous welt on the back of his neck.
Fucking groupies cracked me, then they robbed me.
Shit. You okay? What'd they take?
Fine. Nothing. Jar of weed and some costume jewelry.
Yeah.
Costume jewelry?
Hell yeah. I'm supposed to wear a $500,000 Audemars Royal Oak Concept Flying X to fucking amplify? Mm-mm.
I guess not.
Hey, y'all. We got a problem.
Clinton and Nima turn to look at her. She holds her phone out to show them a gossip blog headline. Leaked nudes of Clint Hook. Washed up rapper caught slipping.
What do they mean, washed up?
Roll credits. End of episode. Thank you.
That was fantastic.
That was fun.
That was so cool. I liked it.
That was awesome. Thank you so much. And look at all the love you're getting in the comments.
Look at it, look at it, look at it.
Soak it in, soak it in.
That's awesome. That's
dope. Thanks for everybody. Wow, everybody for, great. Yeah.
Nice work.
Great job. Okay, we're going to do a Q&A now, so don't go anywhere. We're going to talk to Dan and Randall and Marshall.
I'm Amy. I am the Development and Outreach Manager here at ISA, but I'm also, in my other life, I am a showrunner's assistant, a writer's assistant on some pilots that you may see coming to the screen soon, and that's how I met Randall and Dan. We worked on a pilot, what feels like a long time ago, together, and I thought of them, bring them into this project, and I had the pleasure of meeting Marshall during this experience. And so we're just gonna have a quick little Q&A. I know it's Friday night, but I mean, let's soak up this incredible experience while we've got it on screen. Why not, right? Okay, so let's start off. Marshall, I wanna talk to you first. I just wanna hear about you, where you're from, how you got into writing. Just give us a little background on you, please.
Sure, well, I'm originally from Providence, Rhode Island. I've lived a bunch of different places. I started writing when I was very, very young because I'm a very emotional person and needed an outlet for it. So I started writing poetry and rap when I was like 10 or 11, 12, something like that, middle school. And then, yeah, now I'm here. I don't know. I've like written in a lot of different forms since then. I had a play go up last year. I was a slam poet for a long time. I've released a couple of albums of rap. And so, yeah.
Okay, so you had this past with slam poetry and with rap. How did that experience and that world inform the script? And especially, I mean, I personally, as a reader, I felt the cadence of the script was potentially informed by your slam poetry. Is that correct?
I mean, yeah, everything's informed by everything. I obviously, the characters in the script are like artists themselves. But I think like more what you're asking about is like how it affected my process in writing it. I'm really, I don't know. I feel like there's very little difference between forms. I think that like form distinction gets like, it gets treated like it's a bigger thing than it is. A lot of the time when I'm writing a script, it feels to me a lot like a form poem, you know, like there's constraints on what types of things I can say and what types of lines people expect. But fundamentally, the like mechanics of telling a story and trying to impart an emotion or a thought feel very much the same to me. The characters themselves being artists, yeah, I don't know. I think slam poetry has been portrayed on screen a couple times, but like mostly in documentaries. And I feel like for a long time while I was in that community, we would joke that there needed to be like a Degrassi type drama about slam poets. And this is like not that, but I do think that it, you know, uses like art community, local art community as a forum for discussing the ways that those things affect people, the ways that like capitalism and art intersect, the ways that like gender and hip hop intersect.
Love that. Yeah. And so Randall, kind of going off of that, and Dan, obviously feel free to jump in too. What was the biggest, when taking the script on as the director and producer, what was of biggest importance to you guys in this script? And what was the elements in the script that you wanted to highlight the most?
Well, first, I think in my haste at the front side, I neglected to thank Dan, who's a great partner for me in this process. So thank you.
Really didn't notice.
you know, as far as getting a hold of the material, I think it just, I mean, the world struck me, obviously, you know, it's exciting to have a piece that has what I think is not just a unique voice, but also a setting that was very inclusive, you know, which was important to me. and it's exciting to work with, you know, emerging talent and people that I haven't had a chance to play with before. And this was going to be a great opportunity for that.
Yeah, I thought there was such a nice heart to the script. And even though, like, Clinton has such a tough exterior, like, you can tell he's got that soft inside. And I like that Nima at the end really brings it out of him, and felt like a great starting off point for a future series. So that's what I liked about it.
Yeah.
One of the things we talked about, I feel like, a lot on the front side was off of that comment about Clinton. I'm pointing to where Dan is on my screen. off of the comment about Clinton and having heart, is that Marshall created a world and characters who have inherent conflict, you know, about wanting to do the right thing, maybe not for the exact right reason, or, you know, having conflicting reasons for doing the wrong thing.
Yeah, I agree with that. And I feel like I could see at the end so many ways that this partnership of theirs could go. And I think you did a great job of setting that up, Marshall, right at the end, where you see their differences, you see why they're similar, you see why they're the odd couple, and that's the series. And I think you did that masterfully. So kind of going off of that, Randall and Dan, what else does Marshall do well as a writer in this script?
Oh, you're just going to make me love on Marshall, right?
I am. It's his night.
sit back and enjoy it. It's not hidden. You know, it really is about that heart, and he's got really a deft touch with the pen. I guess nobody uses a pen anymore. But in doing subtle humor, you know, that makes that draws you in, you know, and makes for very relatable characters.
Yeah, and I thought it was such an immersive world. You know, it really brought me in. It's not a world I've spent a lot of time in. And I felt like by the end of it, I was like, oh, I kind of feel like I'm a part of this world now. And I thought that was so interesting.
Yeah, I completely agree with all of that, obviously. Marshall, did that feel good, Marshall? Did that feel good?
No, it never ever feels good to receive praise to me. I'm super awkward about it. But great. I mean, like, I appreciate all the things, and like, I'm not trying to dismiss it, but it does. It makes me so uncomfortable. I'm like,
I'm sorry.
Can I just turn my video off and you talk behind my back? Is that okay?
No, we'll move right along. Okay. Don't worry. We'll just pass it right by. Well, this question's for you, so you get ready. What are your hopes for this script, and how has the ISA helped you get some recognition with the script?
Sure. Yeah. I mean. First of all, I think just the validation of having someone read your work, experience your work, and, you know, resonate with it and like it and like laud it is really validating. You know, I'm like awkward about receiving that praise to my face, but it does feel really good, you know, to know that it's headed in the right direction, you know, to feel like the text, you know, affected somebody. I like have not been, I've been writing a long time, but screenplay is like kind of a new format for me. And so that was really validating. Like, again, I spent a lot of time as a slam poet where you like kind of get instant feedback, you know, you write a thing and then you stand up on stage and they literally give you a score. And so that this like competitions have like kind of taken that role for me. It's like hard for me to judge if it's doing the right thing, if it's like working as a story without that feedback. And so to get that from people who like have experience reading scripts and reading this format is like really, really validating, you know, and really, really fulfilling. As far as where it's going, I mean, I wanted to shoot it.
Just jump in. I can tell you, we had a ton of entries for this contest, and you were hand selected by our team. So I'm sorry to keep reaping the praise.
No, it's good. This is the thing that I need to get through. But thank you. I'm like flattered. I'm happy that it worked that way. I'm happy.
Straight to the top. That's where he's going.
Straight to the top.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, like, I want to shoot it. I think that again, like, film is like a new kind of production for me, but I like have some experience producing art. And so yeah, like, that's my ideas. Like, I have a lot of other ideas for stories that could be told in this universe, but thing about this universe that I want to tell, Most of my experience in it is in writers' rooms that are highly collaborative, where people have like individual ownership of the work, certainly, but also we're working together to like create a cohesive narrative. And that's kind of what I imagine, you know, I think that the conflicts that y'all pointed out in the script are not imposed, you know, like those are conflicts that I observe in the world. And so I think that the show and the characters are a really good venue for telling that kind of story. But I don't have all of that, you know, like I have one perspective on it. And so like, what I'm kind of interested in is like finding other people who can also tell stories in this universe and like developing it into a more collaborative world.
Yeah. I mean, I think you are off to a good start here. I mean, obviously did the competition in general speak to you? I mean, I know that you said you're new to screenplays. Are you also new to entering competitions? And what about this ISA competition spoke to you?
Yeah, so I finished the script. I mean, I finished a draft of the script earlier this year. And like I said, like was kind of looking for that feedback. And so I don't know, I did web searches on places to send it, competitions to enter. The ones that like really stuck out to me were the ones where the prize was this, you know, the prize was collaborating with people. The prize was shooting a table read. The prize was producing it in some form. The prize was developing it further. I think that a lot of competitions, you know, are what's the word I'm looking for? Like kind of, like end of the, they're the end of the road, you know, like you get the competition and they announce their winners and they're like, congratulations. And like, that's good. It's an accolade, but also like, I don't want this to stop, you know, like my goal with it is to expand it and learn more about it and think about different angles of it. And so, yeah, I appreciated the table read as a venue for that. It's always really interesting just to hear other people read your words. There were like several times during the recording where just people had a different take on a line that I was like, oh, that's not how I meant it. It's not bad. It doesn't not work, but it's just a different perspective on it. And that to me is where all the meaning comes from, you know, like meaning making is collaborative. And so to see other people doing that with the things that I'm trying to communicate is.
Yeah. No,
what I was looking for.
I think that's beautiful. Thank you. That's warmed our hearts over here at ISA. Randall and Dan, what excited you about taking on the ISA table read competition directing and producing role?
Randall, you want to go first?
Sure. I mean, for me, this is a new experience, but I would agree with Marshall that, you know, so many things are terminal rather than collaborative, you know, and it was also, I thought this was an exciting answer to the moment that we're living right now, being in COVID and having to, you know, it's a struggle to share and to collaborate and to produce work. And I think we, as creative people and as a community, like need that outlet and need to be able to exercise those muscles. So we don't have our own atrophy. So it was, again, the work itself was exciting, you know, to see the level that we were going to be able to work at, and the chance to have new collaborations. You know, I'm working on a production now, and I'm often working out here, but the opportunities to bring new people into the tent isn't always that obvious.
Anything to add, Dan?
I just miss being on set. This was so nice to be able to work on something, especially with Randall, who I've been working with for 9+ years, and really collaborate with him and meet a bunch of new actors and meet Marshall, and it's been great. I think we'll be happy to do more ISA stuff in the future too. We love it.
Oh my God, don't say that. You're gonna get emails from me every day. Marshall, I have a question actually from an audience member. Yeah. If you're ready. This is from Nate McCoy. And he's asking, dealing with the idea of selling out was a main drive in this episode. Was that from personal experience or just natural reflection of the industry as writers, entertainers, musicians meet the money aspect of the biz? Mm-hmm. Do you have any anecdote about approaching a line where you felt like you were being asked to sacrifice your art for money and giving up ownership and vision?
So it's definitely from personal experience. I am not any of the characters, which is like a thing that I think Randall asked me during the production process, right? Like they're all of them are my perspective, you know. All of them are like, I think this person kind of thinks this, and I think this person kind of thinks this, and I think this person kind of thinks this. And I think that the idea of selling out is it's a big concept that gets used to kind of obfuscate a lot of smaller things. I think it's very rare that someone comes to you and says, give me 10 million, I will give you $10 million and then I own your art. I think selling out is generally speaking more progressive than that, you know? And it's, so I don't feel like I have like, you know, that experience where somebody came to me and said, you have to change this. I just kind of feel like every note is that, you know, every note is somebody else's take on it that I then have to take back to my writing and go, does this actually match what I'm trying to do? Does this reflect the thing that I'm trying to achieve? Does this like square with the message that I'm trying to impart? Or is this them, you know, trying to push me in a different direction? And obviously not every different direction is bad. Notes are really, really useful for exactly this reason, because then I have questions that other people had to answer. I think money is a really big, terrible pull on art. I think money's a pretty big, terrible pull on everything, but art in particular, because it's, for me at least, art has always been specifically about not that. You know, I've started writing to talk about my emotion and myself, you know, my identity. And that's not compatible with doing something commodified. Like it's just not, you know? So I don't know. I quit my job rounding on 2 years ago now. I guess it's like rounding on last year. I quit my job in July last year, 2019. And I was a computer programmer and I was making pretty good money doing it, but it was not fulfilling me as work. And so I quit my job specifically to do this. And so I'm like kind of struggling with this thing all the time about how much of this is what I mean to be doing and how much of it do I feel compelled to do because I want to advance this as a career. Mm-hmm. But I'm like pretty defensive about it. I hope that the other people involved in the production did not have that experience of me, but I'm pretty defensive about it because I quit my job, because it makes me feel like if I wanted to just do a thing that would make me money, I could have kept the job I had. So I don't think that selling out is like a thing that happened. I don't think it's an event. I think it's an attitude that you have toward your art, kind of, you know, like selling out is any time that you feel like the money is more important than the message. And I also, not to get too deep into it, but I also kind of think that a lot of, because there's money on the line with art, a lot of people are kind of not really artists, which is to say there's no selling out, because that's all they ever meant to do with it was to make money off of it. So.
Right. Yeah.
I'm better than them.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, on that note, what advice do you have to writers watching this, to fellow ISA members? God. Did you love this experience? What
my advice is, don't listen to me. No. I don't have any advice. I mean, my advice is write about what you care about, which I know is like really like generic advice. But I mean it sincerely. I think that I'm a really big Audre Lorde fan, and in Poetry is Not a Luxury, she talks specifically about the way that poetry has been like co-opted to mean clever word tricks and not like the discovery of meaning and not distilling your experience into words. I think that language, written language in particular, has a lot of power to, you know, identify and draw attention to the ways that we as individuals are experiencing the world, and thus to connect us across those experiences, and thus to affect them and improve things and make things better. And so write to do that, you know, like write because there's something that you don't understand and you're trying to figure it out and you're trying to put it into words, right? Because you're trying to like get a handle on your life and what's going on around you. And I think that like trying to make stories that do that, I talk a lot, like when I teach workshops, I talk a lot about writing into concepts, which is like, you know, trying to figure out what you're saying before you try to say it. You know, I think it's like very easy to jump to, I want to write a pilot, or I want to write a movie, or I want to write a book of poetry. And those are all forms and not content. You know, like you need to know what you're trying to say, what you're trying to express. What is your book about? What is your script about? What are you, you know, what are the themes of it? What are you, and those are things that you can't know before you've started writing. You can't know before you've started exploring them. And sometimes you can do that exploration. Like I've done some of that exploration for like poetry and hip hop and capitalism, just by interacting with it and thinking about it and like being involved in it in like a very practical sense. But without that understanding, without that, like, you know, underlying, you know, understanding of the thing that you're trying to express, it's going to be hard to express it. Anytime I'm editing anything for anyone else, the first question I ask is, what are you trying to say and to who? You know, and before you know what you're trying to say and to who, it's impossible to know if you're doing it effectively. And so I think that a lot, my advice is to not jump into trying to say it before you know what you're trying to say.
I love that. Yeah. And I keep reminding myself to listen more and talk less. And if I am going to talk, I'm going to put in a script. So I love that advice that you have. And Randall and Dan, kind of on the same advice track that we're on here, what advice do you have during these challenging times that we're all in to all the writers listening, to all the ISA members listening? What do you recommend to them?
Holy crap. First, I'm going to get a t-shirt that says Marshall. That was an amazing about the art and having something to say. You know, I go back to the collaborative part of it, and Amy, you sort of hit the nail on the head. You know, Granny used to say you have two ears and one mouth, so listen more and talk less. So, as far as advice on how to navigate these times, I think when we are challenged to make anything, and so therefore we will probably make fewer things, I think the more authentic that you can be and the more that you are asking those questions about the work that you are involving yourself with, I mean, this is a good time to be able to do that, because there's a little bit of room and you know, and air to take that time to be thoughtful. You know, the part of the essential question, you know, in this pilot is all about, you know, what is it that you want to accomplish, and who are you going to listen to? You know, I think that Marshall makes a strong point about the difference between, you know, like I think people say sellout like it's a, like it is an event, like it is a one thing, but it's also like a defense mechanism. Like, you know, to get notes is not to sell out. You know, to have notes, if people have questions about something that you're working on, and you truly want to be in a collaborative space to better the art, then that's a note that you listen to. You don't have to listen to them all, but that is something that you need to address. It's not in a vacuum if you want to share. I'm not sure I answered the question about advice, because I'm not sure if I have got any strong advice this week, but there you go.
No, that was great. Thank you so much. And I think that really leaves us on a good note. And something that I love about the ISA is this community. Obviously, you can see in the chat, and Marshall and all of the cast members, please take time to read the chat, because obviously people are just glowing for you. I love this community here with ISA. I love this competition, how we bring together A-list talent, A-list directors, producers with up-and-coming writers and lift their voice. I mean, this is such an amazing opportunity for Marshall and such an amazing opportunity for us to work with Randall and Dan. And we're so very, very grateful and thankful that everyone came out this Friday to watch and listen in. And so thank you so much, guys. Have a wonderful Thanksgiving, and please take care and be safe and be well, and thank you.
Thanks, Amy.
Thanks, Amy. That was awesome.
Thank you,
everybody.
Amy.
Thank you so much. I'd love to have all the actors say hello and goodbye. You're all fantastic.
We're incredible. Woo! Thank you so much.
Hello. Hey. Well done, brother, bringing us to life like that. I like it.
Such a Thank fantastic you. Experience. Thank you, all of you, for your talent, for your passion, your time, and your energy.
Thank you, Molly, Amy, Dan, Randall, Marsha.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.